Good evening, buenas noches. Estamos aquí de nuevo en Los Ángeles with the Smithsonian Latino Center live mobile broadcast in Kid City, Hope Place. I'm Dr. Xochitl Chavez, and this is Alma Catalan, who is the Arts Coordinator and College Access Coordinator for Kid City. Could you tell us a little bit about the center and what you all do here?
Yes, so Kid City is an after-school program. We do college access, college retention, and also academic enrichment for high school students. We primarily focus on getting high school students get ready for college. So we offer classes and to prepare them to take the SAT test. We also offer math tutoring. For our high school seniors, we also give them the opportunity to get a mentor, and the mentors really help them throughout the whole college application process. So filling out the FAFSA, filling out their college applications, writing their personal statements. So a lot of our programming help students get into college. And then the students that are in college, we make sure that they have the support needed when they start college. Especially because most of our students are first gen. So they still have a lot of questions when they start the first semester in college.
And you were telling us a little bit of, earlier about this is not only a place for students to get resources and help, but it also tends to be a location for parents to get assistance and have conversations as their children leave to come and have a space to also come and talk to people who have other children in college as well, first generation students.
Yes, definitely. So a lot of the families, because it's their first child going into college, they have tons of questions. So for example, yesterday we had FAFSA financial aid night. So we had tons of parents here asking questions about, like, do I have to provide X amount of money for my child to go to college? Do I have to pay any loans? Or, you know, once they go off to college, how do I keep in contact with them? Little things like that. They always have tons of questions, so they come to us with those questions, and we provide them with assistance, but also we make sure that we connect them with other parents who have gone through that same process and to give them that support. So then we have like parents calling other parents and being like, hey, you know, my son's at, you know, this college, I know that your son's going there too. You know, what are some of the tips that you have for me to stay in contact with my son?
And can you tell me a little bit about yourself? I know also you're in graduate school at Claremont. So can you tell me a little bit about the work that you're doing? Why are you in this particular graduate program, and how does that translate here to the location that we are in today?
Right, so I actually have a background in theater and film. I always knew I wanted to be in the arts. I also do consider myself like one of the students that I now help serve. I was the first in my family to go to college, and having access to the arts was always kind of hard. So I knew that when I was working in film and theater, I was always kind of like the only person of color and women of color on set. So it made me think about, like, well, what am I doing to change that? So I knew I wanted to mentor. I knew I wanted to work with youth to kind of change that demographic. So when I came to work to Kid City, I knew that I could use my experience and share with the youth here. And so that's when I decided to go back to grad school. And because a lot of the students are always asking, like, oh, well, you know, when are you gonna go back to grad school? So they kind of pushed me to go back to school. And so that was the reason I decided to go back. And I decided to do the arts management program because I know that I wanna eventually create more programming for youth of color. And of course, I need to gain those skills and also do some of that research. And being a student and also working here at Kid City gives me that, both the academics but also the field work that's needed. So that's kind of how everything kind of comes together.
Well, we're definitely having a hands-on experience here in terms of incorporating that accessibility to college as well as the arts. Can you tell us a little bit about who are the folks that made this at that, and why do you have this activity here as part of Kid City Hope Place?
Yeah, so so a lot of the students here are also very artistically inclined, and in particular, Denny Rodriguez, who was the main head behind the artistic skeleton of the Altar, she's actually actually, she actually, these are her original drawings, but she wanted to create this big altar, and she was the one that kind of decided the idea of having to commemorate the people that that we loved and having them being displayed in Little Calavera. So that's how you see, like, the students last time did an activity, and they were able to create a calavera for the person they wanted to commemorate, and then there was a little bit about them. But then they really wanted to make sure that it was going to be displayed like this. And then we have other students who wanted to create their own canvas. So we used this whiteboard, and some of them came in and just started drawing on it. So it also gave them the opportunity to use some of their artistic skills to incorporate it in the altar. And then we had one of our interns do some of the calaveritas here on top. But really, it was a collaboration with all the students. We have other students who helped us create the papel picado, and they were the ones that arranged like how we have it now. Other students learned how to create the flower side of the paper mache. So they were so everything was actually made by the students. So that was also part of the process in creating the altar, but also it was very therapeutic for a lot of the students as they were thinking about who they wanted to remember for the altar. So everything was really made out of love.
And thank you for sharing that. I know that we see many different elements here of what could be activities. Can you tell us a little bit about maybe where did you get the ideas for these particular activities? We see right now, for Dia de los Muertos time, there's so many opportunities and options for people to go out and practice this in like the public space. But how can you bring this practice at home? How can educators and teachers find activities that they would be able to share with their children or youth in a classroom?
So that's a great question. Actually, when I was thinking about putting this together for the youth here, I actually signed up for one of the workshops that MOLA was hosting in October. So the Museum of Latin American Art was hosting an Educators Day for the Dia de los Muertos. And so I attended that workshop, and these were some of the activities that they showed us. And they have a PDF file online, so I knew that I was gonna be able to then just print out a bunch of those and bring it back into the classroom. So I was able to use that activity with them, with the youth here, but also the papel picado, as you can see, can be very time consuming when you're actually making it. And so, because time is always of the essence here at Kid City, Danny, who created the altar, found this also on online through a, I can't remember which website it was, but it was through a college, and they had that. So it was also PDF, and we were able to access that. And some of the other activities we did, we used that Smithsonian Latino Center's resources guide online.
The teacher's toolkit.
So.
Great, and you said that you actually have one of those activities for us,
yes,
right?
Yes.
Okay, great. I will, then can you show us what that activity for the Dia de los Muertos that you were, you found?
So this one was, I got it from the Smithsonian Latino Center Teacher Resource Guide, which is a fact sheet of Dia de los Muertos. So as we were getting ready for the community at that, we also wanted to make sure that some of the kids who don't know about Dia de los Muertos or that don't celebrate Day of the Dead, that they had some foundation and background on it. So for me, this was very useful. It's a fact sheet of Dia de los Muertos. And you know, it was just a sheet, but I was like, well, we need to be a little bit more interactive and kind of get them to participate as we were building the altar. So I decided to create this little, I don't know what you might call it, but
clothesline.
Clothesline, yeah, it's clothesline. Basically, we use everything that we have here at Kid City. So yes. And so, as we were sharing last time about Dia de los Muertos and how we celebrate, those that have not celebrated Dia de los Muertos had the opportunity to learn, so they were able to choose one of the strips here, and then they got to read off of it, and each strip has a little fact about Dia de los Muertos. So students were able to learn about Dia de los Muertos, but also others were able to share how they celebrate Dia de los Muertos.
Great. I'm really excited. Could I actually join you in this activity here with the youth? And we have actually a number of students here with us who are joining us during their mentoring night to talk with college mentors. But we actually have also Alma Sanchez, who is now also has a position here, was one of the youth, and now has a position here. Can you tell us a little bit about what you do here?
Yeah, my name is Alma Sanchez, and I'm the program assistant for Kid City. I help with the high school senior college preparation class. We have around 30 students each week with college applications and mandatory forms. I assist with registration and food donations. Just support for the program and for the high school seniors.
¿Y con quién más tenemos el gusto here at the table today?
My name is Kimberly, and I come to Kid City, and I've been taking a couple classes here. I'm in Alma's class. I have a mentor, I have a personal statement class, I have SAT tutoring. It's really fun here. I really like it here.
My name is Nelson Ramos, and this is my first year at Kid City, and I really like it here too. And it's a really helpful program because I get help with my college apps and financial aid.
Great, and then we also have someone else that we should probably include into the table, right? As well as special guests who has been also assisting us. Okay, so we'll actually continue then on here with the activity.
So, I know we already talked about this activity that we did, but just wanted to talk a little bit more about the other activity that we did last time, which was also part of the educational part. And maybe you guys might want to pick one of your favorite offerings that we practiced when we were creating a VSAT. So the other educational component of the activity was teaching the students what are some of the offerings that are made for the dead when you're creating an altar. So some of the things that we always include is the water. So we have water for loved ones here. I don't know if they want to share something that you always make sure that you have in your altar when you create one.
Well, I don't usually. My family doesn't usually celebrate it. The Día de los Muertos, we don't make that. But I know my parents did when they were back in their home country in Mexico. But that, I guess the practice didn't translate or didn't transfer over here. But I remember in our family fast tonight, there was we had the altar up, and Karen commented how we should definitely include water, salt, and food for our loved ones who have passed away. So I think we also have salt, which is the sheet says it's signifies continuing life. And we also have bread, which represents the dead.
I get to share. You know, so for myself, I think one of the things, if I remember any kind of family altars growing up, was definitely some sort of flowers, be it fresh flowers or maybe some sort of dried flowers that might have been placed somewhere, like even at the cemetery, and then bring it back home, and it would be thrown back into the home altar. So as what this document shows here is that flowers represent death, and the scent guides the soul back. And so one of the things that I think we see here a lot, very representative, is the Cempal Xochitl flower, or the gold, the marigold.
Another thing I know from experience, because my family usually makes an altar every year, is that you should include a photo, because then you know who you're dedicating it to. And you should also include a personal item so that it kind of represents the owner who departed.
When my family makes an altar, they always include the favorite foods, and I think it's kind of funny because they'll be like, "Oh, mom, who are you cooking for?" And she'll be like, "Oh, not you." Okay. So that's definitely something that she always cooks the person that has their favorite food. Yeah.
So that for us that was also important to make sure that for those that were learning about the Día de los Muertos, that they knew some of the essentials of what gets put in an altar. And it was also beautiful to hear from some of the students that already practice it or how they're finally practicing what they include. I definitely love the adding the favorite food component. I know growing up, my mom always cooked real good food, so I knew we were going to eat good. But we weren't allowed to touch the food that was being offered in the actual lab. But this was also part of the educator's night for the MOLA workshop that they had. So, and then the other component that we did was as the students were creating the calaverita for the family member or even pet, because we do have some pets that were are being honored tonight. As they were creating and decorating the calaverita, we also gave them the opportunity to think about why they wanted to honor and this person. So they were able to think a little bit about that person on their own, and then write a little bit about that person. So I think for the students, it was really just a good activity for them to remember them and to think of the positive things and to always remember them in that light.
Right.
So those were some of the three activities that we did here for the Día de los Muertos. And the other activity we did was one of the traditions that we have here at Kid City is that we always share food. So we're always
sharing. Can you pick up the plate and show us what kind of food that
is? So today we have sweet bread. Last time we had yellow muertos bread, but of course this time we're leaving it in the altar. But today we have some sweet bread, and all our and every time we have an activity here at Kid City or when we're open, we always have food donations from the parents. So that's one way how sometimes the parents cannot be here, but they send some goodies. So today we have some bread to share with everyone, and some grapes, and whatever, not that we're also going to be in the altar. So you guys can take a piece of bread, and we're going to also add it to the altar. So we'll be sharing it with our loved ones as well. And also the cempasúchil that we added last time, I also allowed the students, gave them the opportunity to take one, because I know for some of them it was the first time actually like smelling it and feeling the flower. So if you guys also want to take one and add it to your card from here, please feel free to do that, because I can always go ahead and add more cempasúchil here. Oh wait, but I remember you told us it was pronounced different, right?
Well, actually, so yeah, there's quite a bit of history behind the different items that you shared here, and I can see that there's quite a bit of research that you all have done here. I think myself, and coming from an anthropology background, and also from talking with colleagues and a collaborator, Dr. Ernesto Colin, when we were talking about how do people say, there's so many different variations about calling the miracle, right, as we say in English. Some people may call it cempasúchil, some people call it cempasúchil. But to decolonize the way that those pronunciations are, and what I mean by that is when we see these variations, it's because of the way when the Spanish arrived, we see how language changed, and so the pronunciation from Nahuatl then is being changed. What was suggested is it's cempasúchil, so it's cempaolxochitl. But as we see, and you can do Google search, any three of those variations are available. So cempasúchil or cempasúchil or súchil. So that's just kind of a linguistic, anthropological kind of explanation, and to decolonize, right, our language that we have seen and how it's evolved.
So have you seen it in different regions, how it's pronounced?
Different regions? In different communities could also have, say, cempasúchil or cempasúchil. It just depends on who you're working with or talking to. But even some folks may not use the C and they might use the Z. So it's also dependent on linguistic type of variances based on regions, as you were saying. So what is ever spoken in that community? But I do want to actually see how you play your game. So maybe if we direct our attention to that, because I think this is also what's very creative and ingenious about it, is to take an activity that you might find from, say, the Smithsonian Latino Center's teacher toolkit, or say from the Museum of Latin American Art, and make it your own. And that's what makes it, how can we apply it to the community? So I want to see, definitely, if you don't mind sharing.
Yes, so we'll go around. So you can either share how you celebrate Dia de los Muertos, or you want to take one of the strips from the clothesline and read off a fact, you can do that, or you can do both. So do you want to?
I'm going to read.
Yeah.
Oh. People celebrate in their homes creating altars called ofrendas in Spanish that display portraits, favorite foods, and special possessions of their loved ones.
I'll take
that
home. Altars are also decorated with candles and marigolds. The light of the candle and the scent of the flowers, called cempasúchil, are said to attract the soul of the deceased and draw them back for a short time to take part in the pleasures they once enjoyed in life.
Do you want to share something, or you want to read off
of that? I'll share my story.
We can wait.
So my family, even if it's, you know, pretty late in the month, we still try to make an altar, even if it's a smaller one. We include a glass of water, a piece of bread at least, and a photo of our loved one. I mean, it's a thought that counts. It doesn't have to be like a super big altar, but as long as you make one and honor them, that's what I think is important.
Would you like to read that
one? I'll do both.
Yes, great. Yes. You get extra bread for that.
It says, families also visit the graves of their loved ones, cleaning the headstones and decorating with flowers and bringing food and music. This is kind of cool because my parents told me that back when they were in Mexico, they would actually go to the graves. They would go to like the cemetery. Like everyone from the pueblo would go to the cemetery and just go decorate. So it wasn't really like a time of mourning. It was like a really happy moment. So no one was really sad. It was just a time for everyone to remember what was and not be sad about what happened.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Thank you for sharing. And I like the music part. As we were creating the altar earlier today, I had music playing. And I know some of the people who are coming here, we put another playlist of their favorite music. So we had that playing as we were creating the altar. So I like that. That was added to the music. But this is that's one way in how you can play it, and you can always also combine other things. One thing that we also combined last time was we added some popsicle sticks. So sometimes we kind of try to give them different the youth alternative. So sometimes if in case that they don't want to share something or they don't want to read off this, but perhaps they have a question, but they're too shy to ask a question, they would get one of these popsicle sticks and just write the question here. And as we're going around, no one's gonna know who asked the question, but they can pick a popsicle from here, and then we can ask the question. And then everyone can share about they can answer the question, or they can share a little bit about, you know, maybe ask more questions about that question, and then start.
Great. Well, thank you so much. As we've seen here today, there were three different activities, and maybe in the next set after the break, we can do the fourth one that you shared with us. So you can definitely check out these activities on the Smithsonian Latino Center website, and it's the Teacher's Toolkit. There is a volume 1 and 2 that provides activities, as well as there are in English and Spanish, so it's available in both languages. You can utilize them within your classroom or in your home. But I want to say thank you very much a las dos almas for showing us how you do these activities here at Kid City Hope Place. And thank you both for participating with us. With No se vayan muy lejos. We're going to continue it right now with a short break and so we can bring in some more youth and get ready for our next activity. You are watching the Smithsonian Latino Live Mobile Broadcast, and I'm Dr. Xochitl Chavez here in Los Angeles, California.